Schools are struggling to move forward with their reopening plans as the virus continues to surge in parts of the country. Here's Laura Podesta with the very latest on COVID-19.
Kentucky Governor Andy Beshear recommended schools in his state delay the start of in-person classes until late September.
We shouldn't want our kids to be the canaries in the coal mine.
Beshear says cases are near a potential peak and hopes the situation is better in 6 weeks.
It's just getting them back at the height of the pandemic, I think, would be irresponsible.
He also pointed to schools in other states that are facing outbreaks. In Georgia's Cherokee County, hundreds of students and staff are quarantined because dozens of classmates and coworkers have tested positive for COVID-19.
I think it's a powder keg waiting to happen.
Kristen Palasik's 6-year-old son, Marcellus, is doing remote learning in Florida. He ended up in an emergency room 3 times after getting the virus last month.
And you're going to have more and more of children like my son who are going to end up in the ER. So it's scary.
All right. We want to bring in New York pediatrician Dr. Dyan Hes to wade through some of the latest information, doctor. First thing that I want to sort of talk to you about is the American Academy of Pediatrics says that there has been a 90% increase in the number of COVID cases among children in the U.S. over the last 4 weeks. So yesterday, the president was actually asked about this statistic and asked whether or not he was concerned about it. This is what he had to say.
It's a tiny fraction of death, tiny fraction. I think that for the most part, they do very well. I mean, they don't get very sick. They don't catch it easily. They don't get very sick. And according to the people that I've spoken to, they don't transport it or transfer it to other people, or certainly not very easily. So, yeah, I think schools have to open.
Okay, doctor, so I want to get your take on what the president had to say. We have been hearing for a while now that, you know, children don't tend to get as sick. But then we heard these new studies that really differentiated between children below the age of 10 and those above the age of 10. And then he said that they don't transmit the virus very easily. Is there any truth to that?
Well, the studies are very small, and there's only really 2 published studies that we've been reading, but they do say that children less than 10 transmit the virus less, that's for sure. And now you have to remember that these are studies of children who are not wearing masks, and when we reopen schools, the goal is that the children who can tolerate a mask over age 2 can keep a mask on during the day. Of course, the younger kids will probably not be able to wear a mask the whole day, like the 4- and 5-year-olds, but the older kids will be wearing masks. So I do believe that where the rate of COVID is 3% or less, I do think that the schools should reopen. I really think they need to. But I feel like the president, he sometimes mixes words, like it mixes like what when he means well, but he mixes the science. Yeah. And, you know, we have to take reopening schools cannot be done nationwide because nationwide we are not facing the same parameters. So in New York City right now, in New York State, the rate of COVID is 0.88%. In Florida, it's 20% in some counties. So you should not be reopening schools where it's 20%. It should be less than 3%.
Mm. Okay, so that brings me to that photo that went viral from that Georgia high school, the crowded hallway. Kids didn't appear to be wearing masks. 2 of the kids who took a photo in the hallway ended up getting suspended, but then that was lifted.
Yeah.
But now we hear that there's been a small outbreak at that Georgia school. And you point out something really, I think, significant. In Georgia, like Florida, in a completely different situation than, say, New York, that has managed to keep the numbers low now for several weeks on end. But when you see some of the positive cases spiking up across the country connected to schools that are opened, I have to ask you, you know, are we doing the right thing moving forward with schools reopening with in-person classes?
Not in those areas where the rates are high. They should have never been opened. And you mm-hmm. can see how crowded that school was. So in New York, only about 25 to 30% of the kids are going to be allowed in any school building at one time. So that school had like packed students in that Georgia hallway. That won't be happening in New York because Cuomo and de Blasio in New York City have said that only 1/3 of the kids to 25% of the kids, depending on the volume of the student body, can be in the school building at one point. So that would be a ratio of like about 1 to 10 to 1 to 12 teachers to students. clearly in that Georgia high school, none of that planning went into account. That school was packed like sardines, those hallways. Not everyone was wearing masks. So that is a recipe for disaster. And maybe in those states, in those counties where they are not ready to reopen, they have to shut down and they have to stay quarantined, get their rates down, and then reopen like we did in New York in phases. And when you earn that right to reopen, you can reopen because it's just going to be a huge burden. I mean, you want to reopen. They're saying that they want to reopen the schools because you need the economy to succeed. But if you open your school and everybody gets exposed to COVID and all those families have to be, or anyone exposed has to be quarantined for 14 days and tested, you're not reopening the economy. You're putting a huge burden on the medical system and setting the economy back.
Completely. I want to ask you about a new study coming out of the CDC, taking a look at children who test positive for COVID-19. And what the study seemed to notice is that the same disparities that we see amongst adults when it comes to African-Americans and Hispanics, we're also seeing that when it comes to children.
Yes, and this would be about access to health care. So, you know, they say, and I know in New York, we have very good Child Health Plus, and we have a lot of hospitals set up that they have free testing for COVID. But in other states and other cities, it is not the same. I'm on all these Facebook chats with pediatricians around the country who cannot get their patients tested. Their patients are in underserved communities with lack of resources. You know, they might have been sent the rapid COVID test, but they don't have the reagent to develop the rapid COVID test. And they might not have swabs. And now, literally, people were talking about ordering tubes on Amazon and filling them with saline to do our own COVID test to send to the lab because LabCorp hasn't sent us, well, not in New York, but in other states, they don't even have the tubes to send out the COVID test. So, yes, this is a delay in treatment. So if you can't test your patient properly and you think they have COVID, then by the time you get the test back, they might be severely ill or they might, it might have turned out worse because they don't have good access to health care. That is a problem in this country, that we don't have a basic right of health care for all our children.
Mm-hmm. And the CDC also released a report talking about this rare multi-system inflammatory syndrome, something akin to Kawasaki disease that we're seeing in children who have tested positive for the coronavirus. Similar disparities. What concerns you about this?
The same thing. We're not seeing it as much in Caucasian children, but we do see it in Blacks and Hispanics. So are they getting sicker because they had delayed treatment and care? Were their parents afraid where they live that they were going to have a high risk of COVID if they went to that hospital? So maybe if you're in Georgia and you know it's a 20% rate of COVID, you might not want to take your kid to the ER and you might wait and you might, you know, do a telemedicine visit or something like that. So what we're telling parents is, so this MISC, we now know how to treat it and it is treatable, but it's about timing. If you think your child is sick with COVID or having these symptoms of this syndrome, you know, rash, high fever, red eyes, swollen glands, you have to call your doctor and take your child to the doctor immediately. It's about timing and it's about access to healthcare. So maybe if you're in a clinic and you call them that day, they'll say, we're backed up. We don't have any time or we don't have access to see sick kids because we don't have the proper PPE in this neighborhood. We couldn't afford it. We didn't get it delivered. You know, there's so many factors. We're going to have to do retrospective studies to see why there was a delay in diagnosis. But we know in all areas of healthcare, there are healthcare disparities. I mean, there's articles on it every day.
Okay, let's get into this announcement of a vaccine coming out of Russia. Vladimir Putin did a press conference, or he went on television talking about this vaccine. They're making it available, but it has not gone through phase three testing at all in order to ensure the public, I presume. He, you know, said that one of his daughters was given the vaccine. How nervous does this make you?
Oh, this, as a scientist, you know, not as even wearing my doctor hat, just as like an undergraduate researcher hat, makes me quiver. The thought of giving a vaccine that hasn't finished its phase three trials to anyone, let alone my own child, is kind of scary. And it's about ego. Right? It's a competition. I'm going to show that I finished the vaccine fast enough. So we don't even, as far as I know, the COVID vaccines in the United States, the testing that we've done and in Europe has not included children. And usually children are the next phase after. And we have to do very rigorous trials because we don't know the doses to use in children. It's not going to be the same as adult. Just like in the flu vaccine, we have different doses. Just like in many other vaccines, there are different dosage adult versus children. So to go and just go and give your 13-year-old a vaccine that hasn't been tested, you must be really confident or delusional. That would never happen in the United States. And that's why, like, we all want a vaccine to come to market, but we want it to come safely, because if a vaccine is not developed safely, it could backfire on us. So we want it to be safe. I do believe that there will be a monoclonal antibody drug that is going to be available sooner, as per Dr. Fauci. And I think that's where we're going to have to rest our confidence in, and then we're going to wait for the vaccine. I mean, the Oxford trials are very promising, but if you read those studies, they're so rigorous. The patients who are involved go back and get tested every 2 weeks. They give blood, they get nasal swabs, they give stool cultures. I mean, to say that they're already giving a vaccine to humans when it's not done a phase 3 trial is just dangerous.
So, you know, and then if you can make it sort of brief, but what are the dangers of moving forward? Clearly, the virus is very dangerous. Many, many people have died and are dying. What's the danger of moving forward with the vaccine so rapidly?
Well, just like in any vaccine, you have to have trials, and then we continue the trials. You know, we are rushing this vaccine, but we always test the patients afterwards to see if they have any autoimmune disease later on, if they had any untoward effects, joint inflammation, fevers. Like, who knows? There's so many. You can have a myriad of complications from a vaccine that's untested. So it's just, there's too many diagnoses to even go through. What if it caused death? You know, that's why they have to have vaccine trials. And in any publication, in any program where it's a rigorous scientific based background, they would not rush a vaccine to trial because it's ethically inappropriate. Mm-hmm. There's too many side effects
really
to count if it wasn't tested.
Mm-hmm. There you go. I know it's a basic question, but I just sort of felt like I needed to ask it because there has been this push to let's get it out, let's get this vaccine out, you know? But we've seen things go horribly wrong there's a reason why there are 3 phases of testing and why thousands of people are typically included in phase 3 testing. I just also want to point out, when Vladimir Putin talks about his daughter, he's talking about he has 2 adult daughters, I believe. So one of
his daughters. Oh, I thought it was his child. Okay.
He said it was... Yeah. But it's still quite shocking anyways. Dr. Dyan Hes, it's always great talking to you. Thank you so much.
All right. Take care.